The evolutionist camp, they don't want you to think for yourself. They want you to accept what you're taught without questioning.
Eat any good books lately?
Greetings, YouTube misfits, miscreants, malcontents, and misanthropes. Claire's here with her coffee. I just put on a pot. Come on and grab yourself some. We're going to talk about YouTube and YouTubers. But first, a little update on the health situation. In my campaign to deal with the onset of type 2 diabetes, I have now lost approximately 10 pounds in 3 weeks, which means that I'm a third of the way to my goal of losing 30 pounds in 6 months. Well, of course, this past week it's officially been the beginning of spring. Oddly, it's been unusually chilly here. Not that I imagine that's going to last very long, and before you know it, I'll probably be complaining that this part of North Carolina feels like the surface of Venus. It's been another peaceful weekend, Soggy Bottom, and frankly, I don't have a lot to talk about this week. So let's do a couple of shout-outs. My first shout-out today is Jim the Evo, a young man made known to me a couple of weeks ago. He's doing a magnificent series called The History of Infection. And it looks at the history, of course, and the evolution of infectious diseases.
Hi, I'm James Gurney, and welcome to History of Microbiology and Infection. This show aims to put microbiology and infection into a historical context, allowing me to explain some complex microbiology and see the relevance to it in the human context.
Polio only seems to become a problem during the 20th century. It quickly became one of the most feared diseases in history, as it seemed to target young and strong children. Polio is caused by a virus, and this means, like all viruses, it can't be treated with antibiotics. Instead, you need some sort of antiviral or, if you can, a vaccine. There's a common myth that the last outbreak of polio was caused by the polio vaccine, and anti-vax people tend to say, look, the vaccine is dangerous, it actually causes polio, and the levels of polio were on the decline until the vaccine was introduced. The polio vaccine once did cause an outbreak of polio, that is perfectly true, but this was caused due to a mistake in the production process of the vaccine. Furthermore, to say that the number of cases were going down, but that's only if you look at the death rates from polio, which whenever I see these things on websites, it's always the death rates, not the actual polio cases.
Speaking of the anti-vaxxers, in my early days of Coffee with Claire, I gave a shout out for a video that featured a song that I still consider one of the finest on YouTube.
Back in the day, they dearly loved their children and did the best they knew how. What do you think they would choose to do if they knew what we know now? If they could take a peek at our history books, would they marvel at the lives we've saved? If they had our tools, would they think we're fools, or would they go ahead and make a change? Would they follow the evidence to show a strong preference for wild stance? They once knew talk to snake or salesman, rabbit rabbits and talisman, cross their fingers and knock on wood. Doctors rather than infected from playboy bunnies and pet detectives. If now was there in this year tale, they'd run and back with looking folks out of town on a raid.
Well, that's the sublime. Maybe it's time for the ridiculous. Our first nominee is a recipient of the Dim Bulb Lifetime Achievement Award. In the early days of the Dim Bulb competition, he was a dominant force, and he's one of a small number of YouTubers for whom I dedicated an entire series. Unfortunately, he eventually reached my gag threshold, and after that I gave him wide berth. But recently he's done a geology video, and someone nominated him, and I thought, well, why not? Let's bring him back. I'm sure you'll recognize the voice.
Hey, folks. From the American Journal of Science, the dolomite problem. What this refers to is a conundrum in geology. Geologists are unable to answer for the origin of dolomites.
Nephilim free! How are you doing, sugar britches? Let's start out by explaining what Nephi is talking about. First of all, dolomite actually refers to two different but related things. The mineral dolomite, calcium magnesium carbonate, and the rock dolomite, made up primarily of calcium magnesium carbonate. More correctly referred to as dolostone, but nobody does. Now, as I said, the major constituent of the rock dolomite is calcium magnesium carbonate. It's very similar, but somewhat different in crystal structure and chemistry, to calcium carbonate, or calcite, the major constituent of limestone. Now, herein lies the problem. We can go to many places in the world and find massive limestone being deposited, but there are no places in the world where massive amounts of dolomite are currently being formed. There are only a few relatively small, isolated, and extreme environments, which typically are hypersaline and virtually anoxic. And that's pretty strange because there are massive amounts of dolomite in the rock record, including these in the Dolomite Mountains of northeastern Italy. So massive dolomite, or dolostone, has been a bit of a conundrum since it was discovered a few centuries ago. Let's see what sort of answer Nephi can provide.
They are left scratching their heads and wondering, how did the earth get so much dolomite? And the flood of Noah explains it. You see, the flood of Noah caused a tremendous amount of hot water to rush out of the earth. Dolomite was produced chemically. Today in the laboratory they can make small amounts of dolomite, but there's no workable hypothesis for the production of large quantities of dolomite.
Really? A brief Google search turned up all kinds of articles about dolomite. Have you read them? And on what basis have you rejected their conclusions? Well, I must say you're hypothesis isn't exactly a thoroughgoing analysis or explanation of the geochemistry, is it? Overlooking the fact that you really just stated that God done it and left it at that, I did give some thought to your hypothesis and something occurred to me. Carbonates are unusual in that they're actually less soluble in warm water than in cold water. So, wouldn't they have all have precipitated out fairly early in the process, you know, while the waters of the deep were still hot? And then later, as things cooled down, other sediments would have settled down on top of all the limestones and dolomites. But the rock record isn't like that at all, is it now, my little honey nut cluster? Let's go to that creationist obsession, the Grand Canyon. Ignoring the 20,000 feet or so of Precambrian sedimentary rocks that can be found in the base of the canyon, because after all, you guys say that those sedimentary rocks were deposited without benefit of a universal flood in the first 1,000 years of Earth's existence. Looking at the rocks, what we find at the base of the canyon are 1,000 feet or so of sandstones, siltstones, and shales. And above that, we have some limestones and dolomites, but above that we've got about 3,000 feet of shale and siltstone, followed by some more limestone. Now, we can actually trace the rock record even further forward in time if we go over to Zion Canyon. The limestones found near the top of the Grand Canyon are found near the base of Zion Canyon, and above them are several thousand feet of sandstones, shales, siltstones, and conglomerates. And on top of that's a bit more limestone, and on top of that some more siltstone and shale and sandstone. Now I could continue up through the rock record, it's pretty complete out there, but I think I've made my point. What's more, limestones vary greatly in terms of their origin. For instance, the massive Middle Cretaceous chalk beds are made up entirely of microfossils called coccolithophores. Obviously, they are not simply chemical precipitate from superheated waters of the deep. And some limestones in the world are made up almost entirely of fossil coral reefs, For instance, a few weeks ago I mentioned the El Capitan reef complex in East Texas. When did coral have a chance to grow in the midst of the hellish cataclysm that you've described? It's interesting and possibly quite significant that dolomite, unlike limestone, tends to be very fossil poor. Do you recall earlier when I referred to some dolomite that's being formed now? But only in extreme hypersaline anoxic conditions. Well, there's not much macroscopic life that lives in such environments. About the only thing that lives there is bacteria.
The evolutionist camp, they don't want you to think for yourself. They want you to accept what you're taught without questioning.
Actually, Neff, we like questions. But you don't ask questions, do you? You make statements. Long, grossly ignorant, and sometimes massively stupid statements. And speaking of questions, you may have noticed I didn't answer the question, how were massive dolomites formed in the geologic past? I don't know. And I'm not up on the latest in carbonate sedimentology. It could be there is a consensus answer. But it's something I would be happy to research for you, because that's what makes science fun. Perhaps I can report back to you in a geodesy episode. But back to that nonpareil numpty of numpties, no phylum free. When I accepted the nomination, I didn't realize it was going to take me 7 minutes to discuss his video. And frankly, having reviewed it, there is no way anyone can compete with Neffy today. So congratulations, Neff. You are our dim bulb.
Were you born an asshole, or did you work it in your whole life? Either way, it worked out fine, cause you're an asshole tonight.
As is often the case with Nephilim Free in his videos, in that particular video, he went off on some interesting tangents and excreted a couple of other doggy bombs that deserve our notice. So next week, he'll be back again to compete for Dim Bulb of the Week. However, next week, he'll have some quality competition, including the following asshole.
We should be very surprised, for example, to find humans appearing in the record before mammals are supposed to have evolved. We have found that kind of thing near La Salle, Utah, where perfectly modern human skeletons are found in a layer that's also found at Dinosaur National Monument, one that is known for its dinosaurs, in the Dakota Sandstone. Here's one of them still in the rock. This is 50 feet down in the Dakota Sandstone.
That was faux PhD and noted creationist grifter Don Patton. Oh, what a tangled web they weave when creationists seek to deceive. Bish bish.
That settles it.